good morning and thank you for being here. This is obviously a very significant subject, and that's how it's called, significant beneficial owners. And what makes it all the more significant is the tremendous amount of uncertainty surrounding it. If things are clear, perhaps we understand. If things are not clear, we are grappling for what's happening. And given the fact that the date of implementation is just around the corner, if one were to go by the 90 days timeline, that's just about to come now, even though the necessary e-forms for uploading the information is not yet available, which gives an indicator that perhaps the last date might get shifted. The last date might get extended perhaps, but as of now, that's not something that we can bank on. Therefore, we will make ourselves ready to understand and implement that as and when it gets effective. Now, unfortunately, in absence of any clarity from the MCA, there is a divergence of views prevailing. I mean, professionals have indicated different views, and there are fairly divergent and almost like mutually opposite views in certain matters, which is normally that there for anything new that happens, obviously. But in this case, the views could be so divergent that you would probably be at loss as to how to go about implementing should the implementation happen tomorrow. Now, what we are going to do today is to give our views on the rules and the section, and we would try to give the backing, the complete reasoning behind what our view is. And indeed, if subsequently the MCA comes up with some clarifications which are different from what we are opining, I mean, that's something that one keeps a contingency for that. But however, we'll give a complete reasoning as to why what we hold is should be the right approach. So with this, let's proceed with understanding of what these rules are. And I'm sure this is something that all of you know, that significant beneficial owners is not something which is unique to India. Identification of SBOs is something which is not an Indian law. This law is not a part of our so-called identification of Benami companies or shell companies or a drive against black money. A lot of people have perhaps harbored the view that this is a part of the drive against black money. And as the government has taken action to strike off names of companies or disqualify directors, this is somewhat similar. But actually not, because even though the SBO rules are now getting implemented in the Companies Act, effective, let's say, sometime from now, but identification of ultimate beneficial owners has been a part of anti-money laundering laws for some years now already. And this is not unique, because this is something which is there world over. And indeed, in India, this law comes in wake of India's commitment given to the Financial Action Task Force in several years back. As long back as in 2012, when the Companies Act 2013 was in bill stage, you find the government has given a commitment to FATF that we will bring in place, we'll bring into the rule book, rules for identification of significant beneficial owners. So this is a part of the task force, Financial Action Task Force, which is an international body, and the FATF came after, I mean, the international scandals, terrorism-based scandals, which caused substantial loss to humanity, substantial loss to properties. And it was realized by regulators that behind every large-scale international crime, obviously crime needs big-time money, and money moves through the corporate sector. So there are companies which are behind crimes, and as there are corporate entities whose ownership is not even known, because I'm sure all of you agree that currently it's possible to frame companies in different jurisdictions, construct one layer over the other, and keep multiple layers so that the actual owners behind the company could be hiding beyond recognition. And if you use international jurisdictions, sometimes the trail would stop at a particular jurisdiction beyond which you would not be able to know where the ownership trail actually ends. So the ownership of the company might be traveling from here to Mauritius, from Mauritius to Ireland, from Ireland to perhaps Isle of Man, and Isle of Man to some weird jurisdiction from where you would not be able to know who the real owner is. And sure enough, if the intent of the perpetrator of crime is to carry out a criminal activity, he'll consciously design it such that it would never be able to penetrate through the cobweb of layers. So impenetrable, non-traceable corporate ownership, that is what has been bothering regulators for quite some time. So FATF brought several international regulations. That's why it's called Financial Action Task Force. It's a task force which constantly has been bringing recommendations to countries to make sure that corporate entities are not misused for carrying out crime. Among those recommendations is sometimes called recommendation number 32, which says ownership of corporate entities will be transparent. So the recommendation pertains to transparency of corporate ownership. Corporate ownership must be transparent, so it's possible to trace the person behind the entity. What do we mean when you say person behind the entity? Person behind the entity might be another artificial person. There might be a company, and behind the company might be another company. So the idea of Financial Action Task Force is to identify natural persons behind the stress is entirely on identification of natural persons. Why is the stress on natural persons? Because once again, recognition is that wherever there is a crime done, the criminal mentality has to involvement of some natural person. Natural persons do crimes. I don't think companies can do crimes. Companies cannot think bad. Companies can't think. So no question of a culpable mindset on behalf of companies. So companies are inanimate. Companies don't do crimes. Companies are driven by people, natural persons. So natural persons are responsible for crimes, and natural persons have therefore got to be identified as being responsible for whatever criminal activities are carried. So the stress of Financial Action Task Force is to identify the natural persons behind companies. And the fact is that there are millions of entities incorporated day in and day out in different jurisdictions. And India has approximately, I think, about 10 lakh odd companies, despite the massive striking off that's happened. Still a large number of entities, and entities continue getting incorporated. Lots of LLPs also get incorporated. If you think of jurisdictions which are known as lightly regulated jurisdictions, entities are proliferated on a, momentary basis. So entities are created every now and then, and those entities could be owning other entities through series of complex and networked ownership, channels, such that it becomes impossible to penetrate through the web of entities, and therefore the ownership of entities is not even discernible. So that's the objective with which FATF came. This FATF move for identification of ownership of entities started long time back, 1990. And over a period of time, steps have been taken to make sure that there is effective identification of natural persons behind companies. And from, let's say, last 3-4 years, many jurisdictions have started incorporating as a part of statutory provisions for identification of significant beneficial owners. UK was perhaps one of the early countries which enacted a statutory rule for identification of significant beneficial owners. It's not called by the same name in every country. Every country calls it by different name. For example, it's not called SBO in UK, it's called PSC in UK. All UK companies have to identify PSC, persons in significant control. So persons holding significant control need to be identified, and they need to be recorded in the register of PSCs maintained by the company. The company in turn will need to file it with registry offices. So anyone who wants to see who are the natural persons behind the company can go to the registrar of companies and investigate the register of so-called PSCs or so-called SBOs, as we would like to call it in our country, to know who are the persons behind the company. In other words, idea basically is that there must not be any artificial entity where we do not know the person behind that. And I hope all of you can appreciate if the real objective of the FATF is that entities are not used to shield or garb the entity of a natural person who is really behind the entity, then the law should not allow a scope to have any artificial entity where the real owner is not known. Because if I can still create or innovate a type of entity where the real owner is not even known, then the next level of ingenuity is to find such an entity and proliferate those entities. So the idea basically is that there must not exist any artificial entity without a clear, discernible, natural person behind it. Now, FATF is not a legislative body. FATF is an international task force, so FATF gives recommendations to countries, and countries implement identification laws themselves. So different countries have used different thresholds for identification of significant beneficial owners. FATF has given illustrative threshold of 25%. 25% that is a natural person holding 25% or more beneficial interest is the person behind the entity. That's a sort of a threshold, a kind of illustrative threshold put in by FATF, but countries have used their own threshold. You would however notice that most countries have used 25% still as a threshold. For example, UK uses persons in significant control, 25% as a threshold. In US also, there is a complete body called Financial Crimes Enforcement Center, FinCEN, and FinCEN also uses 25% as the threshold for identification of significant beneficial owners. Also, all across European Union, which is several countries put together, Brazil also uses 25%, European Union uses 25%. The point I'm therefore trying to make is that most countries have used 25% as the threshold for identification of SBOs. And you will all appreciate in India also, the ultimate beneficial owners identification, which has been a part of anti-money laundering law or a part of KYC requirements, has been using 25% as a threshold. In, I think about a couple of years back, all of us were asked by all our bankers to sign on complicated forms, and the bankers came and said, what are we signing these forms for? They said, you're signing it for FATCA. And I say, I'd never do any FATCA at all. They said, I'm not meaning that FATCA, I'm using the US FATCA. Then one would ask, US mein FATCA hota hai kya? So that FATCA in US basically was, once again, identification of real owners behind companies. It's the name of US law, which is called by them, incidentally, abbreviated as FATCA. Under that law also, we were identifying natural persons holding 25% beneficial interest. In. So 25% has been almost like an acceptable norm for identification of beneficial owners in lots of countries in the world. Some countries have put in place a strong framework for identification of SBOs already. Some countries are still, let's say, in terms of ranking, they're not as strong. This international information may not be of great interest to us, but some countries have brought in lower threshold as well. 10%, for example. India somehow opted for 10%. And if you were to find out which countries have opted for 10% as the threshold, you'll find those countries are, you can see the names of those countries. The names are Cayman Islands, BVI, Hong Kong is still a strong jurisdiction, but the Hong Kong says 10% for high risk, 25% for standard risk. Unless the entity is identified as high risk entity, it's not 10%, it's 25% for standard risk, but only for high risk entities, 10%. High risk, low risk classification is something bankers always do. And if your banker comes every year for a so-called re-KYC, and you would ask the banker, say, you are in high risk, I'm not sure what risk am I meaning, I wouldn't know, but well, bankers have their own standard for high risk, low risk, medium risk classification. So the due frequency of KYCs depends on whether you are a high risk entity or a low risk entity, etc. Cyprus, Argentina are countries which have chosen thresholds of less than 25. India chose to fall in line with Cayman Islands or Cyprus or one of those jurisdictions to think of a 10% threshold as compared to the global norm of 25%. This is something that surprised a lot of people, because the act itself talked about 25%, and the MCA notification came and used 10% as the threshold. Now we're just taking a little overview of the global rules, because why are we doing this global analysis? Because we need to realize that after all, India cannot be a loner. India cannot be secluded from rest of the world. It's not India's innovation or contribution, original contribution to investigation of ownerships. India is simply falling in line with the rest of the world. And what Indian rule is cannot be completely different from global rules. Every country has its own nuances, but after all, largely it has to fit into the FATF framework. Because this law is admittedly brought in wake of India's commitment given to the FATF, and therefore it cannot be completely unconnected, disconnected with how it is in the rest of the world. So this understanding helps us, because There are several countries which have implemented this for several years now, few years now. They have elaborate guidance notes on how to implement it, and we can also be beneficiaries of that work instead of trying to invent our own wheel. The wheel has been existing for years, so we might as well try to use it instead of trying to create one of our own. So misuse of artificial entities for carrying out criminal activities has been there for years now, and we said that's the intent with which FATF came. There are several ways of obscuring the ownership of entities. These words are used very commonly, shell entities. In India also we use the word shell company, shell entities. No one knows what's a shell company. And now the NJT Srinivas committee has actually recommended to the MCA to bring a statutory definition of shell companies. And I would be happy if a definition comes, then one can play with the definition. If there's no definition, then it's a completely vague word, and anything is a shell company. Where we don't know what is the company, then the company is a shell company. We have also been using a word called Benami companies in India. Sometimes we use a word called vanishing companies. There's a company which vanishes. There are vanishing people, but the vanishing companies as well is once again. So all I'm saying, these are expressions of intrigue. I'm intrigued by what's, I don't know what's happening. So I use a word shell company, vanishing company, or basically what, Benami company. I don't have a name, so Benami companies. So these are usual expressions people have been using, but let's move on because we have a, sure. So in many jurisdictions, there's no limit on directorships. India is one of the countries which puts a limit on directorships. Many countries don't have a limit on directorships. So one individual could be director in 1,000 companies. Lots of so-called tax haven or lightly regulated countries, you will find there is a company secretary office. Incidentally, many of you might have floated companies in Singapore. You would know in Singapore, offices are manned by a company secretary firm. A company secretary firm in Singapore does not wonder that secretarial audit, because that concept doesn't exist in Singapore. But the company secretary will be holding offices and providing directorship in some 1,000 companies. One small cubicle somewhere in a business center will be acting as a office, and will the same individual, Mr. Chan, will be acting as director of 1,000 companies. And that Mr. Chan is a director of 1,000 companies. Or, kyun? Aapke Singapore mein Mr. Chan hi hai na? Mr. Chan is a name that you'll find one Mr. Chan or Mr. Ho Chin in most of these countries who is a director of 1,000 companies. So, unrestricted directorships, and also many countries don't require a natural person to be director. A director in a company could be another company. A company could be director. Lots of countries might allow a company to be director of another company. So you just have a company which is holding a company, and you have the company acting as the director of a company. So if you want to trace the individuals behind the company, the director is a company, the holding company is a company. And you go to those companies, the first company will be director of the second company. So in other words, it's essentially you end up into a inextricable loop. The difficulties which international investigators have found is that if you examine the complexity and diversity of international corporate laws, you end up into a complete inextricable with absolutely no way to come out of the loop and find the real identity. So instead of trying to use the share ownership trail or the directorship trail to trace or to nab the person behind the entity, we would make the real owners liable to declare themselves as the real owners behind the company. The idea of law is that an investigator trying to use a long trail and trying to find who is the Babu behind the screen, and he's hiding behind lots and lots of screens, let the person himself be obligated to make a self-declaration that I am the Babu behind the company. I am the one who is owning the company. So the idea of law is that let the obligation of declaring oneself as the significant beneficial owner be cast on the beneficial owner himself. That's the basic intent of these regulations. Lots of countries also have nominee directors. Does not mean are institutional nominees. In global parlance, when we say nominee directors, what basically means is dummy directors. A person is acting as a dummy for somebody else. He's not the real person. So I'm saying formal nominee directors, informal nominee directors, holding of shares by trust. So the trust has beneficiaries. The beneficiaries are not identifiable, because in very, very often in a trust you have beneficiaries as per the settler's wish. The settler will declare who the beneficiary will be. So this is basically just an indicator of there are numerous ways by which companies could be constructed where the actual interest in the company remains an enigma, and the ownership and directorship of company will give no clue on the real owner or the real person managing the company. Bearer shares, many of these things are not possible in India. For example, bearer shares in the name of a bearer. In the 56 Act, we had a concept of share warrants, which has now been deleted. We don't have share warrants or bearer shares in India at all. We have nominee directors, but then nominee director must also be an individual. In India, directors can be individuals only. And if the person is a nominee director, he still cannot hide behind the surface and say that I have acted as per instructions of my nominator, because even a nominee is also bound by the same duties as a regular director. Some of these things are not just not possible in India, but many countries actually make it possible. Now, we will spend few more minutes to understand the global law of understanding beneficial owners, and then we are over to section 89 and 90, which is what is our agenda for discussion today. So I am doing this long discussion on global laws merely to highlight that Indian law is not intended to be unconnected with global laws, and therefore there are a lot of learning that we perhaps can do from the global laws. Beneficial owner defined by FATF. FATF definition is most critical because the entire body of laws comes from FATF. The genesis of SBOs is FATF definition. So FATF says the natural persons. First, the stress on the word natural person. Idea basically is to identify the natural person. Natural persons who ultimately owns or controls, ultimate ownership or control. Idea is to find the beneficial owner, meaning the person who ultimately meaning what? Irrespective of how many layers he's coming through. He might be coming through layers and layers, but the person who ultimately owns or controls a customer meaning whoever is carrying out a transaction, and or the natural person on whose behalf a transaction is being conducted, and also includes the person who exercises ultimate effective control over a legal person or arrangement. Ownership or control. First indicator is ownership. Beneficial ownership of ownership interest. In many cases, ownership interest itself is diversified, is scattered, or ownership interest is itself does not give an indicator, in which case control. The control once again might mean what? Management control, managerial control. If ownership is not visible, in that case will hold the management responsible as the significant beneficial owner. This is something that we very quickly come to. Also very quickly, that SEBI's guidelines on identification of SBOs, which has been there for some years already, also uses a similar test. Somebody who is beneficially ultimately entitled to 25% or more of the beneficial interest in companies. These are what is called the KYC regulations. So I'm making a quick move through this. This is what's this still the background, and we will very very quickly to come to sections 89 and 90, which is our basic objective. So in understanding what is beneficial ownership, we need to understand that both direct and indirect ownership of beneficial interest is computed. What's the meaning of direct versus indirect ownership? If you think of ownership of shares may be owned by a person who owns both legal as well as beneficial interest. So-called legal owner versus beneficial owner. Legal owner means what? The person who legally owns the share. By presumption, the legal owner is also the beneficial owner. Beneficial ownership means what? The person who is entitled to the benefits of ownership. So the person has to be legal owner by presumption. It means the beneficial owner as well. And beneficial ownership of shares means what? Being eligible for benefits of ownership. Benefits of ownership in case of shares would be what? Right to claim dividends, right to claim appreciation of value of shares, right to claim voting rights, right to claim management rights, right to be entitled to bonus shares, rights issues. So the several threads or the several elements of ownership, the legal owner is by presumption entitled to these threads of ownership as well. So by presumption, the legal and the beneficial owner is the same. There are situations where the legal owner and the beneficial owner get divested. Now this might happen because of either by design or sometimes even by the very structure of the entity. What are situations where legal versus beneficial owners are different? For example, think of a partnership firm. Shares cannot be owned in the name of the firm, but let's say the shares are the property of the firm. So the firm is the beneficial owner, but the shares are legally owned in the name of partners. Partners are legal owners, the firm is the beneficial owner. Sometimes companies say we will not allot shares in the name of a minor, but let's say the minor is the beneficial owner. Legal owner could perhaps be the guardian of the minor. In India, we have a unique structure called Hindu undivided families. Law Commission has made a kind of unique recommendation that, well, it's time enough for people to wind up the concept of Hindu undivided family. So pack up the family and let the family now disappear. Let Hindu owners be Hindu owners and not Hindu undivided family. That's I think it's a very sensitive recommendation, and I'm not even sure whether it would actually carry through. But nevertheless, Hindu undivided family, the shares are owned by the family, but the legal ownership would be in the name of a karta. So karta is the legal owner and beneficial owner would be the family. So legal, sometimes shares are owned in a trust. So trustee is the legal owner, beneficial owner would be the beneficiaries of the trust. So we might hive off legal and beneficial ownership either by active design or by the very nature of the entity itself. That's legal versus beneficial owner. Direct versus indirect ownership, or what we also in India also have a concept of nominal benami owner, real owner versus benami owner. Real owner versus benami ownership. The benami is essentially what? Benami means a person's name is not there at all. The person is an absentee owner, he's a shadow owner. Owner is somebody else, but there's another shadow owner who is the actual owner of the shares. This is purely a situation of faith, a situation of unwritten faith between the so-called real owner and the shadow owner. The shadow owner is, let's say, the owner on surface, but the actual owner is somewhere behind, which is, let's say, called benami owner. A benami ownership, I'm sure you understand, is illegal and is fraught with serious criminal consequences under the Benami Transactions Prohibition Act. Hiving off of legal versus beneficial ownership does not mean benami owner. Beneficial is not benami because it's anyway on record saying I am the beneficial owner. It's not a case of benami. Benami is a situation where the beneficial owner is not on record at all, and that's an illegality. Now, direct versus indirect ownership would mean what? I directly own shares in a company versus indirectly own shares. Indirect ownership, for example, in this graph you can see Mr. X is owning shares in B Limited through A Limited. Mr. X holds, for example, let's say 30% shares of A Limited. A Limited, let's say, holds 70%, or let's say Mr. Z holds 100% shares of B, and B in turn holds 70% shares of A. So Z is not the direct owner of A. In fact, X is the direct owner of A. But as regards Z, he is owning through B. He controls B, and B in turn holds 70% shares in A. So I could say Mr. Z is 70% indirect owner into A Limited, whereas Mr. X is direct owner of 30% into A Limited. So normally, for computing the extent of indirect ownership, we apply a clear multiplier. 100% of 70%, therefore 70%. Supposing the holding of Z in B was, let's say, 70%, I would then say through B, Mr. Z is holding 49%, 70% of 70% into A Limited. So for typical computation of indirect holding, we use a multiplier rule. Situations may not be all that simple. It might be a little complicated as well. And the holdings might be scattered into various entities or might come through various layers. Like in this case, if target company is the company that I call target company, for instance, see P3. P3 is holding certain shares in C. C is holding shares in P. P in turn is holding shares in target company. P3 is also holding some shares directly, let's say, in P Limited, but the holdings can come through various layers as well. So at any stage, if you want to compute what's the indirect ownership of one of these individuals, we'll have to multiply. At each stage, we'll use a multiplier rule to find the holding. For example, P1, 100% holding in A. A is holding, let's say, 0.43 in P. P is holding 50% shares in target company. So holding of P1 would be 100% multiplied by 43%, multiplied by 50%. To find P1's holding in target company, the holdings at each of these layers, we use a simple multiplier to find the ultimate holding of the person in the company in question. This is how the computation of indirect holdings is done. Sometimes situation might be even different. Now, this is an exaggerated case. The example is exaggerated, but the exaggeration is only to prove a point which is actually there in practice. The example itself may not be seen in practice, but lesser variants of this or more complicated variations of this are surely there in practice. So I am exaggerating merely to prove a point. The point is what? Think of two companies X and Y. See, the holdings between them are what I call looping or circular holdings. X is holding 100% shares in Y. Y is holding 99% shares in X. Instantly, I'm sure one of you would come back and say, how is this possible? Because X is holding 100% shares of Y, X is the holdco of Y, and a sub-C cannot hold shares in holding company. So there's no question of Y holding shares back in X, because X is the holding company. I did mention that this is an exaggeration, but I'm sure a little ingenuity, a little modification will now prove the point. So if holding of X could be split between, let's say, X1, X2, X3, X4. Supposing there are four companies instead of one, each holding 25% in Y, and Y holds shares back in those companies. Now, holding of Y could also be split among various companies. So all I'm basically trying to say here, net worth is circulating back into a loop. It would be too oversimplistic to make the net worth circulate between two companies. That's very clearly visible. And that because of the rule that subsidiary cannot hold shares in holding company will perhaps be ruled out as well. But that does not stop us from splitting the holding into various companies or making the holding pass to one or three or four layers so that eventually the net worth circulates back into the back to the place where it started from. So circulating net worth circulates back, and therefore we have a false sense of net worth. You could see here the real capital of both X and Y in this example is the real capital is only 1%. The 99% is merely an illusion because that's just circulated back. It came back to where it started from. So if you were to for a minute eliminate the circulating capital, we have a situation where P1 with just 1% capital is holding both X and Y. Are you with me? If you were to eliminate the circulating capital, P1 with mere 1% holding is able to control both X and Y. The rest of the capital is purely an illusion, and if you were to actually consolidate those two, that capital will anyway get eliminated. So we just left with 1%, which is held by P1. Now, if you think or you tell me that this is not real, I definitely don't believe you. Because this is something which we do every now and then. 4, 5, 10 companies, the capital circulates back to where it started from. So net worth would be increased to 100 crores. Actual money with the two companies is only 1 crore. But we can create a net worth of 100 crores by circulating the capital. I mean, the more the velocity of the money or the number of layers through which the entity travels, it would become opaque. So it would become less visible. But this is, however, quite common. In such a scenario, P1 with just 1% capital is controlling both X and Y. So significant beneficial owner identification is not merely concerned with a threshold. As we would just see the definition now, you'll see it says either holds a particular threshold or otherwise controls or has significant influence. That is, capital or no capital, irrespective of how much capital, if you are able to control or have a significant influence over an entity, irrespective of the magnitude of your holding, it would still be a case of significant beneficial owner. This is a very significant point. So as we go back to discussion of the SBO rules, so this is what we straight come to now, because our objective to give this international background was to actually firm up our understanding of how our own rules, the Companies Amendment Act 2017, how our own rule deals with the issue of identification of ultimate beneficial ownership. Now, I would invite your questions in sometime from now, because the idea basically is that we will first deal with the two sections 89, 90, and there I'm sure a lot of practical issues that all of you have. So we'll come to all of that, but let's first walk through these two significant sections, section 89 and 90. There are two separate sections dealing with beneficial ownership, section 89, section 90. Section 89 was there earlier as well. It was not inserted by Companies Amendment Act 2017. It was there in the Companies Act itself 2013. And indeed, equivalent of this section was there under the Companies Act 1956 as well. We had those sections 187C, etc., which were dealing with notification of beneficial ownership. So 89 was there all the time. 90 was there though, but 90 was in a different form. It was that 2% holdings or changes in holdings which were to be notified, etc. That was largely a useless provision, but that provision has now been substituted by this provision requiring identification of significant beneficial ownerships. Now, as I was mentioning, that section 90 actually comes from FATF recommendations and is inspired largely by the UK law. Now, in order to evidence that, as you are all aware, Companies Amendment Act 2017 was based on Company Law Committee, CLC report. And the Company Law Committee report of February 2016, the committee report explicitly mentions that India does not have a law equivalent to the FATF ultimate beneficial ownership rules. India does not have something which is similar to UK law, and therefore India must put these rules in place. So we know clearly that as the Company Law Committee report gave this recommendation, that's how section 90 came. So section 90 is inspired by the FATF rules and is largely on the same model as the UK law on persons in significant control. Now, we need to first appreciate the substantial difference, very significant and substantial difference, between sections 89 and 90. This is something that many of us trip over the difference. Many of us get confused by the overlap or the perceived overlap between sections 89 and 90. But actually, those two sections operate in a different form, a different field. To my mind, the only thing which is common in sections 89 and 90 is the definition of beneficial owner. Otherwise, the two sections are totally different. I mean, there's nothing in common between the two. So very often, a lot of confusion comes because people read section 89 into section 90, or they start reading section 90 into section 89. What do we actually mean by, what is the intent of section 89? Section 89 says what? If the nominal owner is not the beneficial owner, the nominal and beneficial owners are different. In that case, the nominal owner comes and says that my name is there, but I am not the beneficial owner. And likewise, the beneficial owner comes and says my name is not there, yet I am the beneficial owner of shares. That would mean wherever there is a departure of nominal versus beneficial ownership, there the nominal owner as well as the beneficial owner both come and declare that the nominal ownership and beneficial ownership are actually distinct. If the nominal owner happens to be beneficial owner as well, as is mostly by presumption the case, section 89 has no applicability at all. And section 89 would not come into picture at all if the nominal owner is also the beneficial owner. So the purport of section 89 is beneficial ownership and nominal ownership are two different persons. Then both the nominal and the beneficial owner makes a declaration. It is not concerned with size of the holding. Even if I hold one share in a company and I am not the beneficial owner, I've got to go and say that I am the beneficial owner, but not holding shares in my own name. So this is something which is, in case of segregation or dissociation of legal versus beneficial ownership. Section 90 comes with a different perspective. Section 90 comes into play when the beneficial holding is significant. Because section 90 is concerned with identification of significant beneficial holding. So section 89 is only in those cases where legal and beneficial owners are different. Section 90 is in a case where we are focusing on beneficial ownership. So for the purpose of section 90, the beneficial owner may be the legal owner, the beneficial owner may not be the legal owner. Irrespective of whether the beneficial owner is holding shares in his own name or is coming indirectly or is holding shares as a beneficiary and not as a legal owner, if the beneficial interest of the entity of the natural person is significant, then the beneficial owner has to come and declare that I am the significant beneficial owner. So broad lines of distinction between 89 and 90. In case of 89, it does not matter what is the size of the holding. In case of section 89, it does not matter whether the holder is the natural person or artificial person. Even if the beneficial owner is an artificial entity, it still has to come and say that I am the beneficial owner, but my name is not entered on the register of members as a nominal holder. And section 89 is only in those cases where legal and beneficial ownership is distinct. Now coming to section 90, section 90 does not depend on whether the holding is in the name of the entity or not in the name of the entity. So whether the shares are held through another entity by way of indirect ownership, or whether the shares are held directly, or whether the shares are held through or let's say by way of a nominal owner, as long as the holding is significant, the significant beneficial owner would come and declare his holding as a significant beneficial owner. Now, crucial and very significantly, both sections 89 and 90 use the definition of beneficial owner which comes from section 89. So I'm first quickly showing the meaning of beneficial ownership, and once you've seen that, it would be easy for us to understand why are people commonly mixing up between sections 89 and 90. So I'll just put on screen the definition of beneficial owner, and from there we get to realize why is the confusion commonly coming. So as you go to section 89, which was amended by the Companies Amendment Act by inserting a definition of beneficial ownership in section 89 subsection 10. This is where the confusion comes from. Both the sections derive from the same definition. So that's section 89 and this is the definition. Section 89 subsection 10, the definition of beneficial ownership says, for the purpose of this section and section 90, beneficial interest, so it's referring to both 89 and 90. For the purpose of this section, which is section 89 and section 90, beneficial interest in a share includes directly or indirectly through any contract, arrangement or otherwise, the right or entitlement of a person alone or together with any other person to exercise or cause to be exercised any or all of the rights attached to a share, or receive or participate in any dividend or other distribution in respect of such share. So it's defining what is beneficial interest. Beneficial interest is what? Ability to or entitlement to exercise any rights attached to a share. For example, voting rights, or say right to a bonus share, rights issue, or right to receive dividends. Any of the rights or right to receive dividends or distribution, if the rights, a person who is entitled to any of the rights of the ownership is a person who can be called beneficial owner. But 90 is concerned with significant holding. So 90 now comes and says every individual, the moment you talk using the word individual, we are referring to a natural person. Every individual who acting alone or together or through one or more persons or trusts, including a trust in persons resident outside India, holds beneficial interest. So what is beneficial interest? Refer to 89 by 10. That is, definition is common, but the purport, intent, applicability is very different. Beneficial interest of not less than 25% or such other percentage as may be prescribed in shares of a company. Or, I was mentioning earlier, it's not merely dealing with a threshold value of shares. So first part is threshold value or threshold percentage of shares. The person alone or together, he may be holding the threshold level alone, or he may be holding it together. He may be holding it directly or indirectly. So the holding could be either alone or together, alone or together, through one or more persons, that would mean it might be indirect holding. The indirect holding may be through a resident entity or indirect non-resident entity also. That would mean even if a natural person is coming into the company through layers of cross-border holdings, or let's say there's a overseas natural person holding shares in my company, even there the person has to identify himself as the beneficial owner. This is the threshold of not less than 25% or such percentage as may be prescribed. So the government got the right to prescribe a percentage. This is first part, which is threshold. Next it comes the right to exercise or the actual exercise, either the right of exercising or the actual exercising of significant influence or control as defined in section 2/27. So the person may be either holding threshold level, threshold percentage, the person may be exercising significant influence, the person may be exercising control. In either case, the person has to come and declare. If the person is natural person, he's got to come and declare himself as the natural person behind the company. So the idea basically of the law is to force natural persons who have a threshold holding in the company to come and declare themselves as significant beneficial owners. The government, the government had the right to prescribe a threshold. Now the government came and prescribed a threshold. Not only did the government prescribe the threshold, the government also gave purportedly some rules of how to compute the threshold. So they did two things. A, they defined the threshold, and they gave their own rules of how to compute the threshold.